religious leaders set to meet court again over sticky issues before IEBC dialogue. President Uhuru Kenyatta begins a four-day tour of Ukambani, but some leaders cry foul. And Nyeri County intrigues. Governor dares assembly members to impeach him. Good afternoon. It is the 10th day of June 2016. So glad that you're watching KTN News. This is KTN Newsdesk with me, Sharon Momanyu. Welcome to the program. Now, sources have told KTN that religious leaders are meeting CORD representatives to give them the feedback from the Jubilee side after CORD raised a raft of demands they wanted met before the official talks over the Electoral Commission begin. CORD leader Raila Odinga is today expected to issue a clear way forward for the opposition coalition's participation in the talks aimed at solving the IEBC stalemate. Jubilee has agreed to CORD's demand that the number of Jubilee nominees to the Joint Select Committee on IEBC must not be more than 7, but the ruling coalition insists that the secretariat for the Select Committee must be within Parliament. However, even as Kenyans await word from the top CORD and Jubilee leaders, CORD has notified the police of anti-IEBC demos set for Monday. The CORD CEO Norman Magaya has stated in the notice to the police that they would ensure that the demos are peaceful. Right, now after CORD sent their list of fresh demands of what they want done before the talks begin, Jubilee, fired back a response at just about 10 p.m. last night, explaining what they could agree on and where they won't budge. And let's now take a look at some of the specific demands by CORD and the Jubilee responses to those specific demands that CORD raised. And remember that Jubilee responded to them immediately at about 10 o'clock last night. Now, some of the CORD's response, demands rather, that they wanted not more than 7 members from each side of the coalition, to take part in the talks. And Jubilee's response to this particular demand is that is okay. They agree that they will have not more than 7 representatives. And just looking at the next board there, CORD specifically demanded that the appointees should not be subject to a parliament's approval, that whatever the product of that deliberation would be, that they wanted that to be final. But Jubilee stated that the House approval is a must, but that we will lobby our sides to approve all, just stating that both sides should lobby their members in Parliament once that product of the deliberation is subject to debate in Parliament. Now, CORD also demanded to have joint chairs for the Select Committee, and Jubilee's response to that is to let the Select Committee decide. So the committee that both would have sent their members there to decide who are going to be the chair of that Select Committee. Another demand by CORD is that 4 joint secretaries from outside Parliament, to be the secretaries of that Select Committee. And Jubilee's response is never, that it must be the office of the Clerk of Parliament, to be the secretary to this particular Joint Select Committee. And they have insisted that the Clerk of the National Assembly is an independent institution, and that should not be subject to debate, is what Jubilee is stating. Another demand by CORD is that speakers of Parliament should not be involved in that process. And Jubilee has agreed to this, saying that this is okay, but they will help to ensure that standing orders are followed. And taking another look at one of the CORD's demands is that the process should not be subjected to standing orders. And Jubilee's response to this particular demand is that parliamentary traditions and standing orders must be followed, remembering that Jubilee has insisted that, this must go the constitutional way by the standing orders in the Assembly, and just some agreeing to some of the demands that were, put forth by CORD, and also just insisting that some of the traditions in the National Assembly must be followed. Another demand by CORD is that the process should take a maximum of 4 weeks. And Jubilee agreed to this, saying that, the House, this particular business in the House would be urgent, and they want this closed in at least within a month, that is 4 weeks. So just a response there that we've had court putting their raft of demands forward, and Jubilee immediately giving their response to this remand. And just the last demand there by court is that the product of talks must not be rejected by Parliament when tabled. And Jubilee says that they cannot guarantee the outcome of a parliamentary vote. Of course, court has been insisting that whatever this particular joint committee agrees to should not be subject to debate in Parliament. But Jubilee insists that this has to go to the floor, and that both sides should lobby their groups to vote this. And just to help us put this in perspective, thank you so much for joining us. We have political analyst Jared Okello. Thank you for joining us in studio. And just perhaps the first question, what is your take on Jubilee's response to this particular raft of demands from court?
Well, thank you, Sharon, for having me. Mm-hmm. You do understand that court is trying to push as much as is feasibly possible mm-hmm. to have the negotiations be done outside Parliament. Mm-hmm. But Jubilee's response is a pointer to the fact mm-hmm. that before they have been able to flex mm-hmm. their muscles by using their numerical strength in Parliament, and therefore any negotiation outside Parliament, perhaps Jubilee is fearful mm-hmm. that they will have to lose. Mm-hmm. And that is why court is saying that even if we talk about joint secretaries or joint chairs, they must not be subjected to parliamentary orders mm-hmm. to the extent that even an outsider who does not necessarily have to be sitting in either the Senate or Parliament mm-hmm. can be part of that negotiating team. Mm-hmm. Therefore, that is the kind of phobia mm-hmm. that each side is having.
Right.
Court does know that even the final deliberations, and one of the court's demands mm-hmm. was that this should not be again subjected to scrutiny mm-hmm. and parliamentary approval, mm-hmm. that whatever is coming out as a resultant feature from this deliberating team mm-hmm. should just sail through in Parliament, just like they did with the Grand Coalition government, mm-hmm. just akin to what the IPPG of 1997 did do. And that is the position that they are taking. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the kind of standoff that we have continued to see from either side
right.
for Jubilee is that, you know, as much as we may not agree with certain tenets mm-hmm. of the agreement, mm-hmm. we still have a way through parliamentary approval
right.
where we will flex our muscles, mm-hmm. Put into good use the tyranny of numbers, mm-hmm. and subvert certain sections mm-hmm. that probably will not be in agreement with them.
Right, and of course this is a standoff that has taken, you know, quite some time to move forward.
Right.
And would you say that right now we can see at least both sides ceding some ground? We have Jubilee now responding to some of court's, you know, budging to some of their demands.
Well,
would you say that court is doing the same?
Well, there has been rigidity
right.
from Jubilee Alliance.
Mm-hmm.
You remember when CORD did present 1.6 million signatures mm-hmm. that were later on rejected by the IEBC, mm-hmm. that some of them were pseudo-cows and pseudo-elephants, mm-hmm. and that cannot therefore pass to be a signature.
Mm-hmm.
CORD therefore said that we will engage you on the streets
right.
by so exercising Article 37, mm-hmm. which gives them the leverage to picket, demonstrate, and mm-hmm. to petition mm-hmm. to any public authority.
Mm-hmm.
And through that, they therefore said that we need to therefore come up with a negotiating team
mm-hmm.
so that these issues can amicably be addressed.
Mm-hmm.
You remember that lives have been lost as a result from the barrel of the gun of the police.
Mm-hmm.
And today, there is still that standoff,
mm-hmm.
not just within Nairobi, but throughout the Republic of Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
So CORD, having realized that the constitutional route
mm-hmm.
through a referendum
mm-hmm.
wasn't going to work, they have chosen a different route, because there are credible issues bedeviling IEBC commissioners
mm-hmm.
that even if you do not have to go through this route, then you put into good use at Chapter 6 of the
right.
Constitutional Leadership and Integrity, and there is basically no reason why they are still sitting pretty in those offices.
Mm-hmm.
So court therefore said that we are demanding a talks,
mm-hmm.
and by so doing, we are going to be carrying out peaceful demonstrations every time.
Right.
Then buoyed again by the fact that the president invited both Prime Minister mm-hmm. and his co-principal, Honorable Moses Wetangula,
mm-hmm.
they therefore realized that, you know, we cannot just plead to have this done, mm-hmm. but this also gives us a leverage to now demand right. for certain things to occur.
Right.
Now, they came up with a raft of 9 demands yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
I think 3 or 4 of them mm-hmm. have been seeded by Jubilee.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing that is clearly coming out is that Jubilee wouldn't wish to see mm-hmm. any negotiation outside Parliament.
Right.
You remember when the Deputy President chided
mm-hmm.
The 5-member committee crafted by CORD
mm-hmm.
by so saying, you know, if you have Honorable Johnson Mudham and you have Mishi Mboko on the other side,
mm-hmm.
then we are also going to present Baba Yao, Ferdinand Waititu,
mm-hmm.
and Moses Kuria.
And
coincidentally, Moses Kuria's name is appearing.
Right.
So CORD is therefore saying that having suffered from that chide mm-hmm. by the deputy president, mm-hmm. and here comes Moses Kuria's name,
mm-hmm.
Jubilee is not giving this particular mandate
right.
its due respect
mm-hmm.
and due accord.
Because you would say, like, from deputy president's remarks, just saying that if you present these people,
we'll present these people.
Was making a mockery of the whole process.
A mockery, yeah, to create even more scandal.
Mm-hmm.
But again, for me, from a layman's perspective, I would say, therefore, that there is a position that the deputy president has given Moses Kuria, there is a position the deputy president has given Baba Yao,
mm-hmm.
that these are not people whom you can trust
mm-hmm.
to champion a credible exercise that reflects the visions and aspirations of the Kenyan people.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, therefore, we can say that he has put both Mishi Mboko and Honorable Johnson Mudham in a different league.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if these two protagonists
mm-hmm.
are from either side
right.
would still create a further standoff
mm-hmm.
that would affect this country,
mm-hmm.
then I think both teams need to craft
mm-hmm.
a team that will steer this country forward.
Mm-hmm.
Because you will remember mm-hmm. that even today...
So from your take, that the team they have presented, both sides, is not one that you believe...
Well, you know, deputy president is such a powerful person in this country.
Mm-hmm.
And if he has raised particular and pertinent concerns about certain individuals,
mm-hmm.
the best thing that should be done so that we do not see this gridlock
mm-hmm.
Once again
mm-hmm.
is to remove those names and present names that mm-hmm. will be acceptable to both sides.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, again, you remember that each side has been given a mandate to choose its best and
right.
put its best foot forward.
Mm-hmm.
So if Jubilee's best foot forward is Moses Kuria,
mm-hmm.
I think CORD will just have to accept that,
mm-hmm.
but make sure. And that is why they are insisting on the
right.
4 people.
Mm-hmm.
The 4 people as a mini team
mm-hmm.
is only meant to come up with the terms of reference
mm-hmm.
and also what therefore happens after these deliberations have been made.
Right.
So that we do not therefore have a situation where
mm-hmm.
firstly,
mm-hmm.
there will be shouting match
mm-hmm.
During the deliberations.
Right.
And number 2, that even what shall be agreed upon will not be universally acceptable
mm-hmm.
in Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
So if this is the time to iron out and thrash out any issue
mm-hmm.
that may still come on the way
right.
of the success of these deliberations.
Okay.
I was coming to this point. That today, even as we speak, it has economic ramifications
mm-hmm.
Through what we have seen in the recent past.
Right.
We have a declining shilling.
Mm-hmm.
We have a distorted money markets.
Mm-hmm.
We have joblessness. And you know, every Monday and every Thursday,
mm-hmm.
beginning next
and
Thursday.
And the business people saying up to 80 million shillings is
have
lost.
Been lost. Yes. So
right.
it has very serious...
I'm told our time is up, so maybe that last... My final point
is that I think it is incumbent upon the president because he has to take the leadership.
Right.
It falls under his purview
mm-hmm.
to ensure that this country moves forward.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to leave a legacy that will be looked
mm-hmm.
even not just with this generation but the generations to come.
Mm-hmm.
So it falls squarely at his doorstep
right.
to put things in order.
Okay.
And that this, as they have proposed,
mm-hmm.
30 days maximum, they have to work within that particular time frame.
All right. Thank you so much. Jared Okello speaking to us on that response by Jubilee and what it implies to this particular impasse on the IBC. Thank you so much for making time to join us. Now let's go to the controversy of another kind, and this time at the Supreme Court, where the retirement age dispute pitting Deputy Chief Justice Kalpana Rawal and suspended Judge Philip Tinoi against the Judicial Service Commission is being heard. This morning, Tinoi's lawyers, led by Feroz Nwoji, have been making their submissions. And for more on that, let's now join Timothy Otieno from the Supreme Court. He joins us by way of phone. Timothy, perhaps you can let us in on what today morning's submissions were all about.
Well, Sharon, today morning's submission was surrounding a directive that was issued by Chief Justice William Mutunga on the 30th of May, a directive that basically overruled a previous directive that was issued by Justice Njoki Ndungu, that the case against the appeal for the retirement age for Kalpana Rawal as well as Philip Tinoi be heard on June the 24th. Basically, Sharon, if I could just take you back slightly before I could let you know where we stand. Of course, the Judicial Service Commission had written to both Rawal and Tinoi requesting them that they retire once they attain the age of 70. Rawal and Tinoi went to the High Court to appeal that decision. The High Court upheld the decision of the Judicial Service Commission. Then they then moved to the Court of Appeal, and the Court of Appeal agreed with the ruling made by the High Court that indeed Rawal and Tinoi were required to retire by the age of 70 according to the current constitution. So Rawal and Tinoi now went to the highest court of the land, and that is the Supreme Court, to challenge that and really basically to lay their case before the Supreme Court that indeed they were supposed to retire at the age of 74 based on the old constitution. Now, before the Supreme Court could even hear that appeal, there was a directive that was issued by Njoki Ndungu that the case for that appeal be heard on the 24th of June. 3 days later, on 30th of May, the Chief Justice overruled that directive by Njoki Ndungu and required the case to be fast-tracked for the sake of time. Remember, Chief Justice William Tunga is a man who is leaving office in the next 6 days. So he had directed that the case be heard earlier than the 24th of June. Now, that is the bone of contention. Justice Kalpana Rawal, as well as Tinoi, questioned that directive, insisting that the Chief Justice does not have constitutional mandate to override a directive issued by a judge who sits on the same bench as William Tunga. And that is the basis upon which today's case was being argued by Feroz Nwoji on behalf of Justice Philip Tinoi. Yesterday, Kioko Kilukumi was arguing the same in regards on behalf of his client, Kalpana Rawal, that Chief Justice William Tunga would not within his mandate, quoting a section of the Constitution 163A that is believed to have been violated, that touches on the Chief Justice's role as the head of the judiciary versus his role as the chairman of the Judicial Service Commission. Now, Sharon, as it stands, the court has adjourned until 3 p.m. All sides of this case have been heard, and the five-judge bench, by the way, in which Chief Justice William Tunga as well as Njoki Ndungu are sitting, are expected to issue directives this afternoon from 3 p.m., Sharon.
All right. Thank you so much, Timothy Otieno, there, just giving us details on those court proceedings that are taking place at the Supreme Court regarding that dispute on the judge's retirement age. He tells us now that the court has adjourned to resume at about 2 o'clock. So we shall continue talking to Timothy there to tell us how that proceeds. Welcome back, and thank you for staying with us. You're watching KTN News Desk. Now, Kenya's President Uhuru Kenyatta has begun his tour of Ukambani today with a visit to Tala to check on the progress of the upgrade of the Tala-Oldonyo-Sabuk Road. The president will visit Kitui, Machakos, and Makueni counties to launch development project as he seeks to persuade voters to re-elect him next year. The president will commission construction of the 51-kilometer of the 300-kilometer Kibwezi-Mutomo-Kitui Road, nicknamed the Road to Ukambani Votes. Machakos Governor Alfred Mutua and Mwingi Central MP Joe Mutambu are leading a group of MPs urging the community to reject the opposition. And even as Uhuru visits the Ukambani region, members of the Wiper Democratic Movement have expressed concern that State House has not provided them with the itinerary of the president's three-day visit in Lower Eastern Kenya. Wiper Chairman David Musila also said that the CORD co-principal Kalonzo Musyoka will not be available to welcome the president in Ukambani.
Stand. The visit to Makueni has been cancelled. We understand. We have not authoritatively been informed. But these are the politics, and we want to tell our people that for development we are united. And we want it to be very clear, for development we are united. We want the government to give us development because it is our constitutional right as a community. But when it comes to voting, of course our people are clearly in CORD coalition, and no amount of coercion or development will make our people change. That should be very clear to anyone going to our region. He should be going there for development. And we are assuming the president is going there for development. When it comes time for politics, we will politic. And we welcome the president to do our development, because that is our right. And we don't understand, Mr. Amimo, why we have not been given the program, because the last time we visited the president, we agreed he visited us in 2-3 weeks to launch the road, because our agenda was road, mainly. And now that then we hear rumors he's going, we cannot say we will not go, because that is why we ate gas. And